So, hello once again. You look like a bunch that has a lot of questions, so I'm not going to take any more of your time. Give it up for Riccardo.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I hope you all had a nice lunch. I did, at least. So today we're going to talk about the Async Showdown. I hope my screen will... there it is. So the Async Showdown between Java Virtual Threads and Kotlin Coroutines. For those of you that don't know me, which is probably everyone beyond the first row, I'm Riccardo Lippolis. I'm from Rotterdam, which is in the Netherlands, or Holland, in case you don't know where the Netherlands are. And my occupation is basically building quality software, hopefully. I don't care much about the title, so call me a software engineer, DevOps engineer, architect, whatever. Just let me build software and I'm happy. And I've been doing that in Java for more than 15 years, and the last, well, approximately 5 years, switched to Kotlin. And this picture here you see of me is actually me in 2019 being here at HeapCon talking about Kotlin with my colleague Jorrit, of course, with a hipster shirt on. And besides talking about Kotlin, I also did talks about reactive programming, coroutines. So talking about virtual threads was basically a logical next step for me. And people were asking, okay, now that we have virtual threads, do we still need coroutines? Do we need to switch everything to virtual threads, or how do they relate? So hopefully today I'll give you some insight into that. So I want to start out with a huge spoiler. No, coroutines is not going to go away now that we have virtual threads. But it's also not the case that you cannot have any benefits of virtual threads while using coroutines. I think both have very nice underlying concepts, and they do have some overlap, but also some fundamental differences. So I hope today I will show you these similarities and differences. Okay, so let's take a step back and decide, okay, what problem or challenge are we actually trying to solve here? As you all probably know, especially if you see your monthly cloud bill from Amazon or Azure or whatever, resources like CPU and memory, they cost money, right? So we want to optimize this resource usage to use them as efficiently as possible to reduce cloud costs, but also to be more sustainable. So taking a typical Java application, a web server that serves some HTTP requests, traditionally, the thread per request model is used, which basically means that every incoming request gets assigned a thread, and that thread is responsible for handling the complete request until the response is generated. And during the entire duration of that request, that thread is assigned to that specific request. So as we know, and I mentioned it earlier, threads cost resources we want to bring down. And the thread, of course, they require CPU because of the context switching, and basically they're doing some work. And also memory in terms of the stack, some operating system native thread that is assigned. So with standard settings, a Java thread already takes like 1 megabyte plus just to have that thread. So if you try to visualize this, imagine we have this beautiful... you're not seeing... okay, I'll do it without a pointer. In the middle, you see a nice application that has some logic. It has a thread pool, currently only 2 threads, just to show as an example. And on the right, we see a cloud, which is some API we need to call to serve a request, and we see a database that's also needed. And on our left, we see some people that have a request. So every time a request comes in, a thread is assigned to that request. And it's stuck to that particular request all the time during the handling of that request. And you see, when it turns red, it's basically waiting for either the API or the database to return and do something and continue. So the last 2 requests, they take some time before they're even picked up, which is something we might want to improve because, well, threads currently get blocked. Basically, they're sitting around waiting, doing nothing, which is waste of resources. And we have some potential scaling issues. Might not be applicable to everybody, depending on how many requests per second you receive. But if the number of requests grows, you can imagine that you cannot handle more requests than the number of threads you have assigned in your pool. So that's where non-blocking I/O comes into mind, which basically is decoupling the thread from particular requests and letting go of that thread per request style of handling those HTTP requests. And that looks a bit more like this. So requests come in, still a thread handles it, but the moment the thread, the request is doing some work somewhere in the cloud or in the database, the thread can return and pick up another request while it's working. And you can potentially still have some delay when there's no thread actively available to continue work, but in the end, the whole process goes a lot smoother, theoretically, of course. The good thing, no needlessly sleeping threads. Like threads do not wait while there's still other work to be picked up. But it comes with a price, because this model is a bit more complex, or a lot more complex for some, in terms of coding, debugging. But there's also more thread context switching, which might be of impact depending on your use case. So there's a question, OK, how do we implement this in a nice way? If you just look at the JVM when we have completable futures, but yeah, we all know from JavaScript, we don't want this callback hell. So at some point, people were turning to reactive programming. So I told you before I did a talk about reactive programming, which was, well, back in 2016, along with my colleague, Bas. And back then, there was already like RxJava or RxJS. There were some reactive libraries, but then Spring Framework came up with Webflux, which was basically their reactive implementation for web applications. And even then, we already noticed, like, okay, yeah, it's nice that we now have this reactive non-blocking thing in our application, but it's still like hard to debug. The stack traces are all weird. It requires a totally different programming model. It's more like declarative instead of imperative. So yeah, people were not happy with it. Well, some were, but like for the normal use cases, people still use the traditional Spring MPC. So enter Project Loom. For those of you that don't know, Brian Getz is one of the Java language architects, so he knows something about the JVM. And basically what Project Loom involves was creating this threading model for the JVM in which the programmer, the developer, did not have to worry too much about the complexities of like the things we try to accomplish, for example, with reactive programming, but still get the benefits of having this non-blocking style of working. And it's not just I/O, but I/O is, of course, a big candidate for this. And he said, like, OK, I think Loom is going to kill reactive programming. It's, of course, a very bold statement. But I think in for some use cases, he does have a valid point. So Project Loom consists of three separate parts, the virtual threads, structured concurrency, and scoped values. And I'll handle all these three in a moment. Regarding the availability, virtual threads is the only part of Project Loom that's currently available, production ready. The other two are still in preview, but of course you can start playing around with them. But yeah, the most important part of the whole thing is, of course, virtual threads. So let's start with that. So pre-virtual threads, basically pre-Java 21, applications look like this in the sense that whenever you have some piece of code that you want to run on a thread, a JVM thread is assigned to that, and below that there's an operating system thread. Every time you start a new thread or you submit a task to an executor, it ultimately gets run on a certain JVM thread, which is coupled to an operating system thread. So it starts out when you just run your main method that's already on one of those threads. With virtual threads, it becomes a bit more like this. The standard threading model that you're already used to from pre-Java 21 still exists. You still have threads that you can create, start, run, pull, etc. Starting from Java 21, those are referred to as platform threads, which is just the same thread you're already used to. It's just called platform thread to label it as a thread that's used to just run stuff in the traditional way, you might say. Besides that, the JVM also creates a pool of carrier threads, and carrier threads only have a different name because they have different usage, but in terms of technology, they're still same threads that, same as platform threads, you might say. But they're dedicated to run virtual threads. And a virtual thread is not an actual thread. It's more of like an abstraction that's from the user code perspective. It's basically a chunk of work, you might say a runnable, that you are running on a virtual thread, or no, on a, sorry, on a carrier thread. So it's called virtual thread, but it's not an actual thread. But interface-wise, it's a virtual thread, which looks like a traditional thread. The only difference is where it runs. So imagine we have two virtual threads, or two tasks, you might say, and we want to run that on a single carrier thread. How would that work? So I'll try to visualize it here in a basically a time frame way where at some point in time, we start with virtual thread one, which wants to perform some logic. So carrier thread is free, so virtual thread one can do its work. And at some point, you see where the yellow part begins. That's where virtual thread one makes a blocking IO call, for example, a database call or HTTP call, whatever. It needs to wait until some other external entity responds. So at that point, the virtual thread needs to wait. So that means that traditionally, if you run this on a platform thread, the thread would need to wait as well. But seeing as we're using virtual threads here, what happens is virtual thread 2 at some point can say, well, I have work to do now. So the carrier thread can pick that up. So the threads are, the virtual thread 1 is detached from that carrier thread, and virtual thread 2 can run its code on that carrier thread. And at some point, virtual thread one wants to continue, but seeing as currently we have only one carrier thread, which in reality is, of course, more, it needs to wait a little bit because virtual thread is now busy, virtual thread two. And the moment virtual thread two does something blocking, it can pause, block, or suspend, you might say. And then virtual thread one can finish its work, and at some point, two finishes its work as well. So you see it basically interweaves on the same carrier thread, where, as a user, you're just running two threads, but in reality, they get mapped on one thread in this case. So when does the virtual thread suspend? Well, currently in the current implementation, it's all the blocking calls from the Java language, from Java library, basically. So think like socket calls, the reading and writing from a socket. Things I/O streaming, also some concurrent locks that block, wait for an unlock. And there are two things that prevent a virtual thread currently from suspending. And that's a synchronized block. So if you have a synchronized block of code, it will not suspend during the invocation of the whole synchronized block. So keep in mind that if you are running a piece of code that has synchronized blocks on virtual threads, make sure that the block doesn't take too long, and especially make sure that you're not doing any I/O inside that that block, because that would be a waste of carrier thread resources. And another part is native methods and foreign functions, which is really small use case, which I think most of us don't really encounter, but it's good to know that if you're doing some native calls from your Java code, it will also not suspend. So use cases for virtual threads, think the thread per request style server applications that we've seen before, because, well, you just get the non-blocking I/O for free, and the way it looks like is still like traditional blocking I/O. So basically, you get this all for free, you have to do nothing. Sounds good, right? So think highly concurrent I/O-bound code, but make sure that you're not using virtual threads for CPU-bound code, because, well, the JVM manages the number of carrier threads based on your CPU core availability. But if you're doing CPU calculations, then basically you're blocking your hijacking the carrier threads to do your CPU calculations, and it can never suspend that piece of code because it's just calculating code. So run that using normal threads. That's better. And keep the I/O stuff on the virtual threads. So creating virtual threads is very straightforward. You can just pass a runnable to the thread.startVirtualThread method, and it starts on the pool of carrier threads. You also have a new virtual thread per task executor, which basically provides you an infinity pool of virtual threads. I use the term infinity pool because, well, it may seem like it's infinite because you can just start up virtual threads however you want. But keep in mind that, like an infinity pool, there is some limit. At some point, the infinity pool ends as well. And your resources are always limited. So don't try to pull the virtual threads yourself. They're really meant to be like one-off tasks that are lightweight. So they're like fast to create, and they're also easy to destroy, because basically a virtual thread gets its memory reserved on the heap. And well, as visitors of heapcom, we're a fan of that, right? So sorry for the bad joke. and they're much more lightweight than traditional threads because they don't need that much of memory. So it's cheap to create, cheap to clean up. So no need to pull them. So do we get better performance when using virtual threads? Well, like always in software, it depends. So measure whether or not it gives you a good performance boost. I heard stories of people saying that it increased their efficiency by a lot, and others said, well, in my use case, it didn't matter that much. So measure it yourself, try it out to see if it helps you. If you're interested in more in-depth articles or talks about performance with Loom and with virtual threads, I recommend these two talks. On the left is Mark Thomas. He's one of the developers, contributors of Apache Tomcat. So he knows what he's talking about as well. And he did some low-level measurements comparing virtual threads to regular threads, and also gave some insights in what it meant for Tomcat to have to implement the functionality of supporting virtual threads, for example, removing those long-running synchronized blocks. And on the right, if you're like more lighthearted mood, there's Mario Fusco, who basically showcases a game of life implementation of using virtual threads. So it's fun to see how he did that. So moving on to structured concurrency. As we know, concurrency is hard. It's difficult to reason about the code you're reading when it's doing all sorts of weird stuff on different threads. And it's hard to have some guarantees when you read the code, like, OK, what gets executed when and why? So when we look at like traditional single-threaded code, in this example, it's cooking pasta. Just by reading the code, you can already have some assumptions or guarantees about the code. For example, the prepare dish will run before serve dish in the cook pasta function. So you know that if serve dish is running, prepare dish has already run. So if you look inside the prepare dish function, you know that we first create the pasta and then we create the sauce. So just by reading it, you can already reason about this code, saying, OK, I know when I see a stack trace, I know which part of the function has already run and which hasn't. So what if I told you that we could do, well, practically the same thing, but then with concurrent code? Or at least get closer to that. So that's what structured concurrency is about. Basically, you are given a way by the JVM to structure your concurrency. So you can read the code that's doing the concurrent work, and at the same time, reason about the order of execution. So in this case, we have a prepare dish function that is a structured task scope, which is a new thing included in the structured concurrency functionality, which is basically a closable block of code. So that's why we're using the use function here, which is basically like a try with resources style function, but then in Kotlin style. Don't worry about the shutdown on failure. It's not shutting down the JVM. It's basically saying, like, when something goes wrong inside of this block of code, we want to stop executing all the asynchronous tasks that are run. And the way it does it is just calling thread.interrupt. So yeah, depending on the implementation of your code, it will stop immediately or the moment it checks for thread interruption. So inside this scope, we can fork asynchronous tasks. I'm not going to make a bad joke about fork and spaghetti, but I still did. So as you can see here, we're starting two separate asynchronous tasks. We're preparing the pasta and we're making the sauce, and we get back a future. So you can see that, well, we can do things synchronously, asynchronously. And here we join the scope, which means just wait until everything is done. And if we encounter a failure, throw an exception. You can already see, like, it feels a bit noisy, this API, but yeah, I mean, it's the first version of structured concurrency, so maybe it will improve, and maybe people will build some nice libraries around it, but I'm just showing the low-level way of using the structured task scope here. Of course, you can abstract this all the way into nice functions. And in the end, when both our tasks are complete, we return our dish. So, like I said, it's an early implementation, so it's all still a bit basic functionality, but it gives a nice way of structuring your concurrency to make it easier to reason about. And by the way, it's not limited to virtual threads. When you don't specify anything, it will start virtual threads for your forked tasks. But you can give your own thread factory instance so that you can also just use normal threads. And the idea is that this becomes an extensible thing that will, well, improve in future JDK releases, but also third-party libraries can build on top of this. Moving on to scope values. Scope values, simply put, enable sharing data within and across threads. So they're a way of scoping values within a certain block of code to a certain value. So how do we do this? We create a scoped value. In this case, I'm using principal, which is just an authentication object, you might say, so user role or something. And I create a new instance of a scope value. Using the scope value.where block, I can say that within this block of code, the scoped principal scope value will have the value of normal user in this case. So within this block, we are a normal user and we can do normal user stuff. So you can see in the do normal user stuff function that if we get the value from scope principal, we get back the normal user. When we call the get function outside of a scope value.where block, we get an exception. And within that block, that value is immutable, so you cannot change it. However, what you can do is create a nested block. For example, when you want to temporarily elevate your rights to administrator, and then you can do admin stuff. And outside of the block, again, we're a normal user again. So it's a nice, clean way of scoping values to certain values. So yeah, here you're thinking, well, we have thread locals for this, right? Yeah, we can still use thread locals. Thread locals are bound to virtual threads and not carrier threads. So basically, the way you're using thread locals still works with virtual threads. And they can still be used to pass context, like logging MDC context or some information about transactions or security even. However, make sure that if you're using the thread locals for caching, what people often do, for example, for objects that are expensive to create, they store that in the thread locals, and especially when that thing is not thread safe. Don't do that anymore with virtual threads, because basically virtual threads should be easy and cheap to create. So if you create that expensive object every time a virtual thread gets created, you'll run into performance issues. So the people in the room that are already familiar with Kotlin coroutines might think, like, yeah, I mean, virtual threads, sure. We have suspending functions already. Well, we have structured concurrency already. And we have a coroutine context, right? So yeah, I'm now going to show you what's the difference there. Suspending functions basically work the same. I will not explain the whole picture again, but basically instead of virtual thread 1 and 2, you have coroutine 1 and 2, and it runs on some dispatcher thread, which is a thread that's provided to you by the dispatcher you're using to run your coroutines. And the principle is the same, right, in theory. But there are some differences. First of all, suspending functions are built on top of the JVM because the Kotlin compiler basically changes your suspending function when you're compiling your code. So that's why it's difficult to call a suspend function from Java code once it's compiled. Where virtual threads are an implementation that reside inside the JVM. So there's no mangling of your source code, basically. The suspension points in Kotlin coroutines, they are user-defined, so they're not limited to what the JVM provides you, or in this case, the Kotlin compiler. You can create your own suspending functions, which have their own points where they suspend, where the JVM is currently JVM internal only. I don't know if they have plans to open it up to us to be able to define our own suspension points, but currently, it's just the predefined I/O functions, etc. And suspending functions you can dispatch in your own way because you can define the dispatcher. So you can say, I want a single-threaded dispatcher, I want a default dispatcher, I want I/O dispatcher. So you get control over the threads that are used to run the coroutines, where virtual threads are just on carrier thread pool only. So there's no choice to be made there. Structured concurrency. Well, basically, same principle, but a bit cleaner API. Again, in theory, it's the same thing, but in practice, I like this more. It's more compact, right? But we'll have to wait to see how the JVM counterpart will develop there. Coroutine context, same idea. You can create your own coroutine context element. And for those of you that are not that familiar with coroutine context, you can see it as a sort of like a map of key value pairs that are linked to your coroutine. So you define a coroutine context element. And in this case, the scope value is actually has a cleaner API, but this works too. And same idea. You can call the with context function to say, within this coroutine context, within this scoped block, I want the value to be a normal user. And same thing, you can override it for child coroutine context, where you can set a different value. So virtual threads, we have suspending functions, structured concurrency is available in both. Scope values versus coroutine context, like we can do similar things. So what's the big difference, right? Well, there are some fundamental differences. The first of it being implicit versus explicit. So virtual threads, they are very implicit. You just say, I want to run this piece of code on virtual threads, and all of a sudden you get all the benefits from virtual threads. You don't have to manually define suspending functions. You don't have to do anything complex. You can just run your code as is, but using virtual threads instead. Where Kotlin coroutines have a different style of coding between the asynchronous style and the synchronous style, or the suspending and non-suspending style, where you cannot just mix them always that easily. So if you're interested in the theory behind this, like what's better, I recommend this article, What Color Is Your Function? If you're not taking a picture now, I will share the presentation at the end so you can look it up. If you ask the famous people, Brian Getz is a fan of the implicitness, where he says, well, I want to offer the Java language developers all the ease of the implicitness, where they don't have to do that much to be able to achieve nice results. Where Roman Elizarov, the language architect from Kotlin, former now, I think, he is more of a fan of the implicit style of program. The explicit style of programming, where he says, well, if you make it explicit, you know where the division is between your asynchronous and synchronous code. So use cases. Kotlin Coroutines has a lot of use cases already, you know, like asynchronous computations, asynchronous UI is used in Android a lot. Well, we can do stuff in future, sequence generators, channel-based concurrency, actor-based concurrency, like a lot of things. Virtual Threads currently only has one use case, which is IO-bound JVM application, which is it's a good start, but I mean, Kotlin Coroutines offers so much more now, right? And target platform, yeah, as you probably know, Kotlin is multi-platform, right? So if you use coroutines, you can use them across all the platforms that support Kotlin. And when you use virtual threads, well, that's a JVM-only thing. So some people ask me, like, OK, can we combine coroutines with virtual threads? Well, you can, but should you? Again, I would say measure it. I mean, it's easy to just create a Kotlin coroutines dispatcher using Project Loom, the virtual thread executor, basically, to do your blocking stuff on a virtual thread dispatcher. But yeah, I would say measure whether or not that gives your application any performance impact, because there are some optimizations in the coroutines library. For example, if you switch from the default dispatcher to the IO dispatcher, you can stay on the same thread, where if you use virtual threads, that would mean switching to a virtual thread. So there are like some caveats that might impact the performance in a way that you would not expect. So what now? Well, the reactive high-level concepts of, for example, non-blocking IO and the scalability and elasticity it provides, that's all still valid, very good points. But if you're using the reactive or planning on using the reactive frameworks just to get that non-blocking IO, I would say stay away from that. I did hear recently that if you're already using a reactive framework, for example, Project Reactor, there are ways of using virtual threads there as well. So what Project Reactor did in one of their newer versions was switching their scheduler internally to virtual threads, so that if you have virtual threads available, they're using it as well. So you can just keep using your reactive framework, but also benefit from virtual threads. So if you're using Kotlin coroutines, yeah, just keep using them, because they offer so much more than virtual threads at the moment. And if you want to play around with virtual threads, start using it, because yeah, it's production ready and it can give some nice improvements. The future of Loom. Yeah, so adoption in libraries and frameworks is already very advanced, I would say. So Micronaut, Quarkus, Spring Boot already all support it. I think with Spring Boot 3.2, you just have to set an application property and you get virtual threads. So it's nice. They did a lot of work internally to make sure that they fixed all the issues that could arise by switching to virtual threads. Structured concurrency constructs, yeah, they will improve. The JEP for structured concurrency will expand, will give new functionalities in the future. And maybe we'll see more Kotlin coroutine style constructs as well in the JVM soon. And it might even be nice if the internal Loom API would be opened up at some point, so that even Kotlin coroutines during the compilation phase might also benefit from using that Loom API. But it's hard to say if that's going to happen now. So with that, I want to wrap it up and say thank you. If you want to see the presentation, I think this is the longer version of the presentation in this URL, but it's basically the same information. If you have any questions, well, I have 1 minute left, so either ask it or just use the WhoVibe. Thank you.